All right, good morning, everyone. It is, it feels like fall out there, doesn't it? Well, my name is Jim Kilmartin. I'm the lead pastor here, and I just want to welcome you all today. It is a good day to be in the presence of God, isn't it? Y'all were quiet. It's a good day to be in the presence of God. Yes. So today, I want to encourage you. I want to encourage you to worship God. You come into a beautiful place like this. We're incredibly grateful to be here in the Mishler and to have the Mishler host us. Sometimes you can get distracted from the lights or you can get distracted from the beauty around. But today I want to encourage you. It's a day to meet with God. He wants to meet with you intimately, individually. He's not a God that's far off, but he's a God that's near. Some of the logistics for today, restrooms are in the back. We have ushers back there. The men are over there. The women's is over here. If you get up, be sure to have your mask on. Sitting in your seat, you don't need to unless that's what you want to do. But we're glad you're here. Is there anybody here for the very first time? Yeah, all right. Good to have you guys here today. This is where we make you guys all stand up and do a dance, okay? Okay. Well, it is so good to have you guys here. Church, let's worship God. Let's give him all our heart today. He's given us all that he has. And in return, let's worship him. Would you all stand to your feet? For those of you that are new, we do have connect cards out in the lobby. Ushers can give those to you so we can just keep in contact with you. We do have a mug and a journal in the back that says Center City on it. If you turn these in, feel free to grab one of those. But what I want to do is I want to pray. I want to welcome the presence of God. I want to welcome the Holy Spirit in this place as we exalt the name of Jesus. So if you would join me in prayer. Lord, we thank you. God, we thank you. Your word says, enter your gates with thanksgiving and your courts with praise. So this morning, Jesus, we thank you. Mighty God, we thank you because there is no one like you. We thank you for how you watch over us. We thank you for the ability to breathe again today, to rise up again today. God, I thank you for the opportunity to gather like this in this place. God, I pray blessings over this house. I pray blessings over this facility, over this staff, over the finances of this organization here. God, we say thank you. And now, Lord, may we enter your courts with praise. May we lift your name up, taking our eyes off of ourselves, taking our eyes off of our circumstances, and we set our gaze upon you. For you're worthy of our praise. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. I encourage you. Let's worship the Lord. Yeah.
Thank you. God is speaking to you today. God is speaking to you right now. God is good. God is good. Some of you have this misperception of God, and I'm telling you right now that He's good. He's good. There's a story in the Bible of Mary and Martha, and Mary took time to sit at the feet of Jesus and rest and be at His feet, at His side. And Martha's running around. She's being distracted. She's being caught off guard. Some of you are being distracted. You've been distracted throughout this week. You've been on Facebook, Instagram, whatever it is. Your work's been more important than what's been going on. And you need to take the time right now and search your heart. Because He is worthy. He is worthy of our praise. And He's speaking to the heart right now, to your heart. And He's asking you, do you see me? Do you see me? Do you see Him? He's good. He's been working things out. He's brought you here today. He's brought you here online watching. He is good. Will you open your heart to Him now? Will you open your heart to His ways? Will you open your heart? Wind down. I want you to take that moment. Take a moment. Close your eyes. Open your heart to Him. Open up that area that you've been saying, I don't want you in that place, but I'm okay if you're not there, but I'm here. As long as you stay there, Jesus, I ask you, I'm challenging you. Open your heart to Him now. Take a moment. What is it for you? Where is it for you? Sit at His feet. Sit at His feet. Sit at His feet. God, we thank You. We thank You for Your love. We thank You for Your goodness. We thank You that You make the darkness tremble. That Jesus, You make the darkness tremble. So whatever distraction, storm that you're facing this week, He is making it tremble. And so God, we thank You. We thank You. We thank You. We give You all the praise, all the glory. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Let's give the worship team, Josh, guys, team, fantastic. Have a seat if you want to. High five, air five, smile. God is good. He's good. He's good. Well, it's good to see you guys. Good to have you in the house of God. How's everybody doing this week? Good? Having all right? It's getting better? You know, I always think of like, this is it. This is the start. This is where you set your time. You fix your eyes on the Lord, and this sets your week in motion. But I think oftentimes we find that where we set our hearts in motion, sometimes we end up stopping on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and hope to get back Sunday. I challenge you this week, sit at his feet this week. Take a week and just sit. Just sit. I have a few announcements to make. We're going to do our tithes and offering as well, so you can get that ready as we go through our announcements. Ushers, as I go through our announcements, you can step forward. But City Blessings is coming back next week. City Blessings is our food ministry where we reach the city. We bring probably 500, 600, 700 boxes of food. We deliver it. So a couple things you guys can do. You can come. You can come help us serve, pass out food, but you can also be a mouthpiece. You're the voice of God here in the earth. And so you can say, hey, I got this thing, or we're giving out food at my church. You know, come be a blessing, grab some, deliver it. Maybe you talk to your neighborhood or your neighbors and say, hey, we got this thing. I want to bless you. Come receive what the Lord is doing here. So that is next Saturday at 10 a.m. Okay, we start at 10 a.m. That's when the delivery starts. Also that night, we have a special guest coming next week. And if you've been in our church, if you're new, this will make no sense to you. But if you've been around, Patrick Kightley is coming back. Patrick Kightley is fantastic. All I can say is fantastic. I'm going to leave it at that because I want you to come. So we have two opportunities. So the youth and young adults, Saturday night at 7 o'clock, right here, come. Hear what the Lord is saying to your generation, to you young people. I'm just going to say it as a teacher of young people. It's your time. It's time for not just them, but it's time for all of us. But youth, it's we wake up. It's an awakening that's happening in and amongst the youth and young people. So come, youth and young adults, 7 o'clock. And then Sunday the 20th, at 10 a.m., right here, same time, same place, Patrick will be here as well, sharing a word of the Lord for this church and for this region. After service, there's a members' luncheon. Okay, members of Center City Church, you would have gotten an invite, but there's a member luncheon down at the Triangle Building, which is down that way at the end there at the corner. If you haven't RSVP'd to Amy, make sure you do that ASAP. And then, fiddling through. Morning devotions. How many of you listened to our morning devotions before? Any morning devotion people? Morning devotions start tomorrow. Tomorrow, 7 o'clock in the morning on Facebook Live, Center City Facebook Live. Get on that. The devotions are powerful. They're brought to you by just people here. We're going to be empowering and equipping you. Get yourself. This is your opportunity. For those of you that are like, I don't really know how to sit at the feet of Jesus, this is a chance for you to sit 7 a.m. and get that, get the word in you and go forth in your day. So devotions start tomorrow. Now, kids, City Kids, parents, if you have a child that is City Kids, so our City Kids ministry, which is up the street, it goes up to age 12. And once you hit 12 in the church here, it's time to start launching you into things. I think I have my daughter, she's up there, or a couple young adults are up there. She's 13. She's running slides. It's an empowering. It's an equipping. So if you have a child that is 12 or just turned 12 from September to now, we want to honor you. Okay, we want to honor you. And it's going to be on the graduation. Our City Kids graduation is going to be on September 27th. All right here on stage. So please sign up. And here's how you do it, parents, at info@centercityaltoona.com. Okay, we want to honor those young people. We want to launch them and get them going into the next things that God has for them. All right? Sound good? You guys are a little sleepy. Come on. Wake up. Let's go. All right, so we're going to do our tithes and offerings. Just real quick, what happens is we're just going to stay in your seats. We're going to pass the basket. So when you get a basket, just keep passing it along. Don't hold on to it and like, what do I do with this thing? Keep it moving. Keep it going along. And so I have a verse for you before we do our tithes and offerings. And I want to share it with you. It's from Proverbs 11:24, and it says this. It said, one person gives freely, yet gains even more. Another withholds unduly, but comes to poverty. One person gives freely, yet gains more. Sometimes, and I'll just share this with you, God, this tithing, offerings, they're to build and advance the kingdom of God. And more importantly, just like it is that you're sitting at their feet of Jesus, he's working on your heart. He's working, he's doing surgical surgery on your heart and in this area of giving. He wants to deeply touch you in this area. It's such a powerful thing. Think about this. One person gives freely, yet gains even more. When you take your hand that's closed off and you're like, no, that's mine, that's mine, that's mine, that's mine, that's mine, that's mine, and you open it, now you have a chance to catch. You know, I teach kids phys ed, so whenever they're like this, they can't catch the ball because they're closed. God wants you to open your heart in this area. So as we give our tithes and offerings, get those ready. If you have yours, just hold it up. We're going to pray over them and bless them. Father, we thank you for the ability to give. God, I thank you for what you're doing in our hearts in this area of giving. And God, I pray that you would take every offering, every tithe, every seed, every first fruit, and multiply it. Bless it, and bless those that are giving. Bless those online that are giving. God, we praise you. We thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. So remember, go ahead, ushers. Make sure you pass it. Don't hold it. Pass that. Pass it. It's like passing the ball in basketball. Keep it going. Keep it going. You can do it. You guys are quiet. They are quiet. I think Pastor Jim's coming up. You guys are about to get woken up. He's about to get woken up. You guys ready for the word? They're ready. They're ready for the word. So Pastor Jim's going to be bringing the word. He's ready to go, I can tell. So I'm going to get off. Guys, be blessed this week. Have an amazing week.
All right. How good was that worship this morning? I think we need to finish with that song today, Tremble. I don't think we're quite ready, or I don't think we're quite done yet with that song. So worship team, let's finish with that one at the end. Hey, well, good morning, everyone. Good morning. You guys, can you talk to me today? Good morning. All right. So let's see, today. Another thing I want to highlight for you is we're a church that prays. And as we launch forward here, we're moving forward into 52 days of prayer and fasting. Wow, that's a lot. 52 days of prayer and fasting. Why are we doing that? We're leading up 52 days to the election. And Nehemiah chapter 6 talks about how the wall was built around Jerusalem, the calling of God on Nehemiah to build the wall, and it took 52 days. So same for us, 52 days, and we want to build the wall, and then we also want to set those gates in place. And we pray, and I encourage you, when you vote, vote according to the Bible. Vote according to Scripture, and I won't tell you who to vote for, how to vote, other than this right here. Let this be your standard. Let this be absolutely, positively your standard. I have a conviction on that, and I welcome sharing with you. So, 52 days, we kick it off tonight. I'm going to get on Facebook Live on Center City site and do a devotional. And each day of these days of devotions, we're going to pray for our nation, because the nation is being rocked, it is being shaken, and the people are being rocked and shaken. And therefore, we need to see people turn their lives, their hearts back to the Lord. And so as we gather, 7 a.m., probably about 20 minutes, 15 to 20-minute devotional every morning, get you going for the day, and then we're going to pray together. We're going to pray for our nation. And we pray for the righteousness and the goodness of God to come. Sometimes God's goodness shakes us. This week in our men's group, we were talking about different things. And sometimes a storm comes so that it protects us and shakes us down so we don't get what something else is coming. And we have to understand and have our eyes ready and watching. Even in the storms, God's in the middle of that, and pay attention to it. So we do a lot of praying. We have prayer Tuesday night at our brownstone building next door, 7 p.m. Wednesday morning, 9 a.m. Saturday morning, 9 a.m. We're in there. We are praying. We're praying for you. We're praying for this city, and we're praying for the nation. And I invite you, come and join us. If you're like, I don't know how to pray, well, we have some people that are there that know how to pray, and they'll teach you. Sometimes you don't have to say much. You can just be there, get a little osmosis, and see what it takes. And we got some prayer warriors in this house, and in that, I want to honor some of them, because today is Grandparents' Day. Did y'all know that? If you did not know that, you better know that. Today is Grandparents' Day. So are there any grandparents in the house today? If there are, would you please stand up? Where you at, grandparents? I want to say to y'all, y'all can sit down now. I don't want you to get too tired. I just want to say to y'all, you have such an important role in this church, and you have such an important role in this hour, that the wisdom and the character, and many of you have fought many fights in your lives, and I'm telling you, this is an hour that the boomers and older and whatever's in between there, it's a time for you to rise up, not shy back. Not be silent. It's time for you to disciple. It's time for you to raise people up and teach them how to pray. Teach them how to walk in honor, to walk in integrity. So I charge you, and I honor you today. A couple other things. So we do have Patrick Kightley coming, and right after that, we have our members' luncheon. It's going to be good, 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 good. So Patrick Kightley, Mark didn't dive into it too much, but I've known Patrick now for years. Patient preacher. He's a seventh-generation preacher. His family were circuit riders way, way, way back in the day that used to travel through Pennsylvania preaching the gospel. They ended up going into California, or actually into Canada, and they settled up in the northwest of Canada. And his grandmother, who is Violet Kightley, she, if you know much church history, and if you know much about some of the people of church history, and he was used by God to raise dozens of people from the dead. I mean, so, walked in such power. And then when he traveled, he used to stay at her house. So these are the stories, and these are the things that Patrick grew up in. Then he and his father pastored a church in Oakland, California. And then he took that church over, and he pastored. And while he was there, he had the likes of Steph Curry and Draymond Green and Klay Thompson from the Golden State Warriors that would come to his church. And then he became a chaplain for that team. It was pretty cool. And then a number of years ago, he launched into planting a church in Atlanta, Georgia. So now he's on the outskirts of Atlanta, and he is a prophetic voice. He's a prophetic voice. Next weekend is Rosh Hashanah. That is the Jewish New Year. That is a turning over, and it's a significant thing in the world, and it's a significant time. And so to have a prophetic voice to come into the house is going to be really, really important. Saturday night is geared toward teens and young adults, but y'all are welcome because we're on worship. We're going to get with God. You can come and pray for the teens and the young adults that the word of the Lord would be delivered to them. You guys that are here from colleges, I'm telling you, come, get your friends. It is going to be powerful. You teenagers, get your friends here. It is going to be powerful. For some of them, it will be life-altering. And then he'll be with us Sunday morning. So that's a couple things I wanted to share with you, and I'm excited. Yeah. The other thing, you know, we a couple days off, but you never want to forget 9/11. You never want to forget 9/11. Why? There are many people that lost their lives, and there are many people that gave their lives for the sake of others. And things that we have to honor our police, honor our fire department, honor those that constantly, willingly lay their lives down, those in the military, and we're incredibly grateful. So today I want to pray for that. I think Friday was also Suicide Awareness Day. And somebody brought it up this morning at the pastor's prayer, but January through April in Blair County alone, there's been 20 through April, so that was only a number of months, with 23 deaths. And recognizing that and understanding that, that's a serious issue in our community. And I believe that God wants to bring some healing to people's minds, to their hearts. And things happen. So it happens with a lot of times police officers, fire department, military as well. So if you all would, I want to pray for that specifically before we dive into the word. So join me in prayer, please. Lord, today I pray specifically for those that are tormented, specifically those that have been attacked, those that can't shake that post-traumatic situations. Lord, I pray healing right now in the name of Jesus. We just sang about Jesus, Jesus, the darkness trembles. Well, God, I pray right now, even in this room, those that are watching, those that are listening, I pray for the peace of God, the shalom of God to come right now in the name of Jesus. Those that have had trauma, those that have had trauma, I pray healing even right now. Dealing with trauma from car accidents, from abuse, from attacks, from family issues. I pray right now for the peace of God, and I ask you, Holy Spirit, would you come into this room and bring peace? God, we honor those that have given their lives for the freedom of people, for the freedom of a nation, ones that lay their lives down in our community day after day. I pray for protection around them and for them. It's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. All right. Well, I want to start with a well-known verse. Y'all would know it. It comes from Matthew chapter 6. His disciples had gathered around him. So if you know, today I'm going to be focusing on Matthew 4, 5, and 6. These are the areas I'm going to be. So if you have your Bibles, you can open up. You can keep it right there. If you have your notebooks, get ready to write a few things. I want to give I'm a preacher. I like to inspire, but sometimes I need to give a little teaching as well, and so we're going to do that. But Matthew chapter 5, chapter 6, starting at verse 5, the disciples are hanging out with Jesus, and they asked him a question, and they said, "How do you pray? Will you teach us how to pray?" In verse 8, it says, "Therefore, do not be like them," the Pharisees, "for your Father knows the things you have need of before you ask him. In this manner, therefore, pray." Y'all want to join me? "Our Father, who art in heaven," and be your name. Come on now. "On earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And do not lead us into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen." Y'all are quiet with that. Do we need to do it again? You haven't done it for a while? You guys have been missing church all summer. You got to get back and you got to remember, right? Okay. So the disciples ask him, "How do you pray?" And he says, "Let me teach you. I want to explain to you, this is how you pray. Our Father in heaven." So you direct your prayers right to heaven. You direct your prayers to our Father, the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. And he said, "Hallowed be your name." Hallowed means, it means holy. It means amazing. We're just singing about it. That how awesome, how amazing he is. So we direct our attention at this point. This is how we pray. We come to the Father. Do you understand that? Do you know that you can come to the Father? Yes, yes, Pastor Jim, I do. Come on, talk to me. Do you know that you can come to the Father? Jesus has invited you. This is how you pray. "Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be your name." Holy is your name. And then the very next thing he says, "Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, our trespasses, our debts, as we forgive those who are debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. So you start in the beginning and you're saying, our Father who art in heaven. You begin with your focus on him, and then at the end, he focuses it again. And for it is yours is the kingdom. Yours is the power. Yours is the glory forever. There's an emphasis there. But what I want to do, we're going to talk about that in a moment here. Matthew chapter 4, verse 17, and you've heard me say this. And Jesus began to preach and say, repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. The kingdom of God is here. So this is really the first time that this is the message that Jesus brought after he came out of the wilderness, after he was tempted for 40 days. Bam, he says, repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. It's right here. It's in your midst. And then the next four verses, he calls Peter. He calls James, John, and Andrew. He says, come on and follow me, and I'll make you fishers of men. And then the very next verse, he says, he went about Galilee teaching in their synagogues, preaching the gospel of the kingdom. So when they said, would you teach me how to pray? He said, let me explain to you. You go to the Father and then you begin to pray as it is in heaven. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. That his desire is for his kingdom to come on this earth. My title today is to be countercultural. The kingdom of God is countercultural. The people of God are countercultural. So my message today is about being countercultural. When Jesus came onto the scene, he shook the scene. He shook the world at its core. And the very first thing, after the devil did everything he could to trip him up, do you know that you're in good company if the devil's trying to trip you up? Do you know you're in good company if Lucifer is doing his job and he's trying to trip you up? And because what happens is, before Jesus ever entered his ministry, that's when the devil was after him. For most of you that you're like, oh my gosh, the devil's kicking my butt. I've been tempted. I've been twisted. I've been tested. And you're like, I just want to give up. I'm about ready to give up. Just on the other side of that is when your promotion comes. See, the devil wants to get you before you ever give up, or before you ever get to where you're supposed to. His biggest temptation is for you to give up. That's why suicide is such a temptation of the enemy. That he would try to pull you from ever becoming what God has called you to do. You hear me? That's why abortion is a scheme of the enemy. And Jesus went about all of Galilee, teaching in their synagogues, preaching the gospel of the kingdom, and healing all kinds of sicknesses and all kinds of diseases among the people. So when he said repent, and he said, for the kingdom of God is at hand, and then all of a sudden he gets up and teaches, and he preaches the gospel of the kingdom, and then he demonstrates it by healing all kinds of sicknesses, all kinds of diseases, people that were tormented, people that were afflicted, people that had epilepsy, people that were paralytics, and he said he healed them. He healed them. That is the demonstration of the gospel of the kingdom. Are we seeing that today? You're quiet. Are we seeing that today? This is the essence of the kingdom of God. That Jesus came to bring salvation, but he came to heal, and he came to deliver. And he came to restore God's kingdom here on earth as it is in heaven. Tormenting, death, divorce, affliction is not in heaven. It's not in heaven. And there's a collision that has to happen between two worlds. Because what we've got into is we've become too comfortable with the culture of this world that says whatever will be, will be. We become too comfortable in the culture that says, let's do unity at the lowest common denominator. Don't step out of the boat. Don't rock the boat. But Jesus rocked the boat every single place that he went. And he said, come and follow me, Peter. Come and follow me, James, John, and Andrew. They had to count the cost. You understand, to follow Jesus, there is a cost. I will never say to you, come to Jesus and your life will be wonderful. I will say, come to Jesus and your heart will be wonderful. Your spirit will be wonderful. But the reality is, the world as we know it is in conflict with the kingdom of God. And that is why Jesus came to this earth. And then that is why Jesus pulled the disciples together. And that's why he gathered disciples and said, now you go do what I've done and do even greater things than I've done. Because I go to the Father and now I give you the Holy Spirit. So if over the years your church has not taught you on the Holy Spirit, you're missing it. Because the Holy Spirit is the most powerful force on this earth in this moment. Jesus sits at the right hand of the Father. When he died on that cross, for 3 days he descended into hell. He took the keys of death and Hades. And then on that third day he rose. He rose. Oh my gosh, that glorious resurrection. I love the cross and I love the resurrection. And then for 40 days he was on the earth ministering, meeting with disciples, teaching them. 40 days. And then he ascended to the right hand of the Father. And then that glorious day came when the Holy Spirit came. Jesus said, I want you to wait in Jerusalem. Tarry in Jerusalem until you've received the gift of the Father, and that is the Holy Spirit. And when you receive the gift of the Father, who is the Holy Spirit, you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. The Great Commission, I talk about purpose an awful lot. You were made on purpose for a purpose. I say every single one of you have been called. How many of you will answer? And then I'll ask you the question, what is your purpose? What you're doing, is it your purpose? And your purpose would be the Great Commission. Matthew 28. Go therefore and make disciples. Go therefore preaching the gospel. Go therefore baptizing those that are following Jesus. Go therefore lay hands on the sick and they will recover. This is the commission that Jesus gives to his disciples. We flip the page and we go to Acts chapter 1. And he says, but you'll receive power when the Holy Spirit comes upon you. Church, you and I need the power of God like never before. If we are truly going to be the church of the living God, then we need to walk in the power of God. Too often there is the church of the once known God. But today we need to walk in the ways of the church of the living God. His name is Yahweh. His name is Jesus. And he has given us the Holy Spirit. And Jesus began to preach, repent for the kingdom of God is at hand. He gathered Peter, Andrew, James, John. He said, this is what happened. Then fame went throughout all the land, and they brought all the sick and all those that were afflicted and all those that had diseases and torments and those that were demon-possessed. Do you understand this is in Scripture? Do you understand this happens today? And that God wants to set people free. I'm going to tell you, since we've moved downtown, I have had week after week after week after week, somebody come up and say, Pastor, do you believe in spirits? Do you believe in ghosts? Do you believe in these things? And I say, absolutely, because it's right here in the Bible. It's right here. And it says, Jesus delivered them. Jesus healed them. With his finger, he looked at them and he told those spirits to be gone, those tormenting things to be gone. The power of God came in that place. And do you know that we need the power of God? Those that have been afflicted and those that are being tormented day in and day out, that the power of God needs to come. And if we are walking powerlessly, then we're empty religion. What determines that you are a Christian, a follower of the living God? The fruit of the Spirit, the gifts of the Spirit, and the character of God. Those are things that we need. The kingdom of God is comprised of five elements. You ready? I'll give you five elements. I'm not going to spend much time on them. I've preached this before, but I just want to highlight it. The kingdom of God, when he says his kingdom come and his will be done on earth as it is in heaven, it's comprised of five elements. It's comprised of authority. It's comprised of law. It's comprised of government. It's comprised of citizenship and culture. Authority, law, government, citizenship, and culture. Number one, authority. Revelation 17:14. Authority is Jesus is king. He's a sovereign ruler and supreme authority. Number two, law. I can give you these notes if you ever want them. Make sure I get them to you. Number two, law. The commands of God are to be written on the hearts of men. He expects those he calls according to his name to obey his commands. We have a law in our house as parents. When we say something, we expect it to be done. And in the same way that if he's called you, Peter, James, John, come on, follow me, Mark, Shannon, Brian, Amy, Derek, whoever, he expects those that he calls to be obedient to his commandments. Number three, government. This is the Lord's enforceable body. We have a government that's around us, but there is God's government. And God's government is the ecclesia. That is the church. It is the function. Its function is to destroy the works of the enemy and establish in each territory the will of the king. Matthew 16:18 and Matthew 11:12. My fourth one is citizenship. This is the new identity of everybody that has been translated from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of light. You are now no longer a citizen of darkness. You become a citizen of heaven, of the kingdom of light. Our nationality has changed, and every born-again child of God is a citizen of God, is a citizen of the kingdom of God. And I would challenge you today that you best be a citizen of God before you're a Republican or before you're a Democrat. And I would best say to you that you better be a citizen of the kingdom of God before you're a citizen of the United States of America. Oh. The kingdom of God trumps nationality. Because my brothers and my sisters are in Africa, are in Madagascar, are in Indonesia, are in India, in England. Those are my brothers and sisters. And it trumps nationality. Guess what? Because nations can change in a day. You see it all over Europe. You see it over the Soviet Union. I grew up seeing the Soviet Union, and all of a sudden, bam, split. Oh, I once was a Soviet Union person. Now I'm of the nation of Georgia. Now I'm the nation of this and that. It can change in a moment. My citizenship is in heaven, is in Christ Jesus. Now, I'm a firm believer in voting. I'm a firm believer in carrying out and walking out the ways of God. If you didn't know, I was the mayor of Tyrone at one point, and I fully believe in people running and influencing and being influencers in the political realm, in the educational realm, in the governmental realm God's called us to. My last one is culture, and this is what I want to highlight today. Culture. It's peculiar. A citizen who recognizes Jesus as their king, observes his laws, partakes in his government, will express his culture. A kingdom culture is one that its citizens reflect the king. This is seen in the expression of the gifts and the fruit of the Holy Spirit. The reality of heaven on earth and the liberty of his people to live out their God-given destiny. Romans 14:17, 1 Peter 2:9. So let me define a few things. I told you I want to give you a couple definitions. I want to break a few things down, and then I'll probably do a little preaching here at the end for you. The kingdom of God is countercultural. So what is culture? If I define culture, it's an integrated system of learning behavior patterns which characterize the members of a society which are not a result of biological inheritance. It's an integrated system of learned behavior patterns which characterize the members of a society, which are not a result of a biological inheritance. Worldly culture teaches us to live according to the patterns, beliefs, and the values of the society that you're in. Traditional church culture is often about preserving the past rather than influence society around them. They often hide within the walls they have created. This inward focus actually counters the culture of heaven and thus forfeits its position for revival and a fresh outpouring of God. Because we get into the point of preservation because it's all about me and it's all about my traditions. The worldly culture teaches us you just do what everybody else does. If sin abounds, then go ahead and sin because everybody else is doing it. But then you go into a traditional church culture and it says, no, this is the way we've always done it. So therefore, we preserve it and we hold on. And what will happen is the very same thing that has happened to Sears. The very same things that has happened to Kmart and Toys R Us, and they say, no, it's a good product, but we're going to do this the same way forever, and they go obsolete. In this city right now, right down the street, there's a church building being torn down. Most of you drove by it on your way here. You turn on off of 17th Street, right onto 12th, it's being torn down. On 6th Avenue, or is that 5th Avenue? What is that one? 7th? 7th Avenue. Church is being torn down right across the street from the ISB bank, the Altoona Junior High. And too often, the church has been in preservation mode and says, this is the way I have always done it. The old guard holds on. But do you understand to follow Jesus? He says, if anyone would follow me, he must deny himself, take up his cross and follow me, and die daily. And die daily. Do you understand that? If you truly are going to follow Jesus, it is not an easy lifestyle to walk. I've talking with Brian this week, and he said, you know, to be in Center City Church, it's not easy being in Center City Church. To follow and live by the Spirit of God is not easy, but it is the best. It is the only way to go. Religion will give you something that's easy to do because you can check the box. I've put my hour in and I'm done. But when you walk with Jesus and you truly follow him, he says, if anyone would come after me, if anyone would follow me, he must deny himself. Why do you deny yourself? Because you want to take care of yourself. You want to be in self-preservation mode. You want to feed your own desires. And Jesus said, but if anyone would come after me, if you say that you're a follower of Jesus, then today's a good day to die. Spiritually. Understand what I'm saying. Today's a good day because he says, if anyone would come after me, he must deny himself. He's got to take up that cross because that cross represents the crucifixion of your old man. Of the way of the world, the way of darkness, the kingdom of darkness, to translate into the kingdom of light, the kingdom of darkness has to end. I have no idea where I'm at, sorry. Traditional church, it is often about preservation, preserving the past rather than influencing society around them. They often hide within the walls they have created. This inward focus actually counters the culture of heaven and thus forfeits its position for revival. Center City Church, we got to be a people of revival. We got to live for the presence of God, for the move of God. We got to see, not shrink back, not hide, but it's a time for us to arise. People of God, it's time for us to arise, not to be silent. This is my amen section over here. I like it. This will keep revival within the preserved walls and will never develop into an awakening that flows fully into society. If you have tasted and you have seen of the goodness of God and you keep it to yourself, woe to you. It is time for us to share it. It is time for us to spread it. Religion will keep you silent. But a true relationship with Christ cannot be silent. It's when you shout it from the rooftops. It's when you say, you are a city set on a hill that cannot be silent. Because God has done something so great in your life that you can't hold back any longer. Culture is held in place by beliefs and values. When we learn the beliefs and the values of a culture, we can relate to the people of that culture. Great. But if we want to live in the kingdom culture, the culture of heaven, we must teach and practice the beliefs and the values of God's kingdom. All right, great. The religious systems, the worldly systems, they have shaped the church's culture today, and it must be challenged because these systems and these patterns tend to restrict the flow of the Holy Spirit in favor of tradition. Now, some of you guys are here at the Mishler Theater, and this is not traditional by any means. The message of the gospel should never change. The way that we present the gospel should change. There are churches, because of COVID, they have closed down because they never embraced doing church online. And they fought it. And they will be like Kmart, and they will be like Sears, and they'll be like Toys R Us. And there'll be a store that you remember. Man, I remember those days when I'd go into Toys R Us. And you remember those days of hanging out in Sears. But all they become is a memory. The church of God should not be a memory. It should be a now. And it should be a present. And it should be a future. See, what happens is when we do this in favor of religion, we do this in favor of tradition, we'll make that statement that says, we've always done it this way. Don't rock the boat. Don't put all your eggs in one basket. And I say rubbish to that. God calls us to live for Him and Him alone. I say it all the time. Well, not all the time, but I say it once in a while. I grew up Methodist. I love John Wesley. I love the roots that I had through John Wesley. But the problem is today, people are still singing the songs that John and his brother wrote 250 years ago. When John and Charles wrote those, you understand that those were contemporary songs. They were Christian songs that were written to bar tunes. They were kicked out of the church for writing those songs. They were kicked out of the church for preaching the way they preached. And the very thing that they fought against is the very thing that has overtaken that church. You and I, we can't do it. We can't let it. My white-haired people that are in this room, I applaud you. And I told you, we need you more than ever. You may be like, I'm a grandparent, I'm a great-grandparent, I don't know how to relate to this generation. All they want to do is play video games and be on screens, and I can't navigate the way they navigate. You don't have to navigate the way they navigate, but you need to come to their level and speak to them. They need to know your love. They need to hear your stories. I sat on a Zoom this past Thursday with Joseph Matera, Bishop Bart Pierce, and his last name is Hurd. He's a pastor down in Texas. And all they did for an hour and a half straight was talk about revival. And I just sat there and I just soaked it in, because when I sit and I talk with Bishop Bart Pierce, and he's 71 years old, and he sits there and he just starts telling us about when God showed up and when God moved, and when the Spirit of God came, a cloud came into the room so heavy, so thick that people could not even get up, and that on the floor there would be circles, pools of tears and of crying because God came, and people couldn't get up. They're plastered on the floor. And I'd listen to him, and I could tell as he talked, he wasn't there with me anymore, because he was back there. Those of you that have experienced God, it is time for you to speak up and share of your stories. and bring them into the now. This pastor's last name is Heard. He's in Texas. He was telling of the story of when Tommy Tenney was at his church. And they were worshiping, they were praying, they were in the middle of church service. And all of a sudden it was like electricity, it was like a lightning bolt, like thundering came into the room. And the pulpit, this big plastic pulpit, split right in half. And he said for the next however many hours, they just laid on the floor because they knew God had shown up. Never to be the same. I need to be around those people. Because I long for the presence of God, not just up in heaven. I'm going to experience the presence of God in heaven. I know it. I'm saved. I'm going there. But I want to experience heaven here on earth. As it is in heaven, I want it here on earth. I want to see God change society. I don't want culture to tell me how I have to live. I want to live according to the culture of heaven. See, there's a difference of being countercultural and subcultural. The church has become subcultural. It has become a subculture because they've lived by fear. And they've lived out of trepidation. And therefore, they've never. That means their religion becomes silent. Because they're afraid of what other people will say. It's a day that the church cannot be a subculture anymore. We have to be a counterculture that says now's the time for the ecclesia, the church of God, to rise up. The people of God to rise up. For those of you who have been tormented by night terrors and dreams, you're afraid to go out at night. It's time for that to stop. Because that is the kingdom of darkness. And if you are a follower of Jesus, then therefore you have the kingdom of God inside of you. And everything that Jesus walked in, you can walk in. So I said, rubbish. God calls us to live for Him and Him alone. The mindset of religious system teaches that the church is a subculture. To stay away from the world. My faith is private. We meet within our walls having feel-good meetings while the world around us is perishing, tormented, and ignorant. A subculture is a group that has beliefs and behaviors that are different from the main groups within the culture and society, according to Webster. Therefore, the subculture isolates itself from the rest of society. Therefore, the subculture isolates itself from the rest of society. We are in a season right now that there is pressure on the church. And if the church goes and hides in this day, it is a time for the church to rise and be an answer, to be a solution. When there are people that are hungry, we better feed them. When people are hurting, we better bring something alongside of them to heal them. If you're honest, the church has lived in fear and a woe is me mentality for way too long. If we're honest, the church has lived in fear and a woe is me, poor me. I'm a victim. The world really doesn't get me. People don't really understand the way I think. I gotta keep it quiet so I don't get beat down. You ready? If your God is king, if your God is the savior of the world, if your God is the healer of those who are hurt, if your God is man's deliverer, if your God is who he says he is, then there is no subculture. Has called us to rise up in this hour. So, I ask you, where are the business people that are supposed to bring the kingdom of God into business? Where are our arts people that are supposed to bring the kingdom of God into the arts? Where are educators that says enough of this garbage that society has told me this is how I got to teach? I'm telling you, it's time to rise up. Where are my preachers that you've been afraid to preach? And we are no isolated group hiding from the larger group. No. God has called us to bring his kingdom, his culture, his beliefs, his values here on earth as it is in heaven. If you're fearful of the media, I'm telling you, the church is so fearful of the media. The media has gripped us so much, hasn't it? You're going to be shamed if you don't have certain things. You're fearful of the government. If the government would rise up someday and say, you guys can't have church, guess what? The church is still going to be the church. But for us, we need to gather. I see the importance, the absolute importance of gathering as a body of believers. Not scattering. There may be a day that persecution comes and scattering happens, but scattering happens to gather again. That's all it is. If you get scattered, then it's time to gather again. The church needs to continue to rise up. Some of us are actually fearful of religious systems. If that's the case, then you've become a subculture and you've walked into no relevance. But my God, he is the creator of all creation. My God is the one who spoke the world into being. My God is the author of the virgin birth. My God is the raiser of the dead. My God is the one who walks on water. My God is the one who calms the seas. My God is the God Almighty. Yeah. Our focus must wholly be on the one true God. 1 Chronicles 16:8. Oh, give thanks to the Lord. Call upon his name. Make known his deeds among the peoples. There is nothing about being silent in any of this. When you begin to know who God is, how amazing Jesus is. There's no silence. There's no fear. There's no trepidation. Because when Jesus walks into the room, fear trembles. We just got into singing that song. When we begin to see who he really is, darkness begins to tremble. Fear no longer has a hold on us. Oh, give thanks to the Lord. Call upon his name. Make known his deeds among the peoples. Sing to him. Sing psalms to him. Talk of all of his wondrous works. Glory in his name. Let the hearts of those rejoice who seek the Lord. Seek the Lord in his strength. Seek his face evermore. Remember his marvelous works which he has done. His wonders and the culture, the judgments of his mouth. It's time to throw down some fear. It's time to call on the name of Jesus. For his name is Jesus. He is God. He's calling you out of darkness, out of fear, out of trembling. And he's calling him to himself. Step into the purpose that God has created for you. I want us to finish with this song, Tremble. And church, I want to challenge you to worship this morning. I want to challenge you to give your whole life to him. Some of you have been battling with this stuff for too long, and you've let your faith be a subculture. It's a hidden thing. When God says, I got to shout it from the mountaintops. Shout how marvelous his works are. Clap your hands, all you people. Shout unto God with a voice of triumph. He has called us to be countercultural, not go with the culture and not be a subculture. As we sing this song, we're going to have an altar up here. We're going to create this space. If you need prayer, if you need to come and meet with God, this is the place for you. Come on up. Come on up and meet with him. If you're in your seat and you're like, I need to know Jesus for the first time. I've been too far away from him. It's time to stop going with the flow of the way the world is, and it's time to give your life to Him. He says, if anyone would come after me, deny yourself, take up your cross and follow me. What good is it for a man to gain the whole world and yet forfeit his very soul? The Lord is calling you today not to be silent and not to live according to the ways of the world and the ways of darkness any longer, but to rise up in this hour and to be the change, be the difference, be the culture shaper. You have a word? There's healing in this room as well. Physical healing and emotional healing that the Lord wants to do in this place.
Yeah, I just felt twofold during worship. I felt this really strong. There's two words, the word engage and the word emerge. And I feel like there's some people in this room that you've been watching church, you've been watching God from a distance, but today's the day of engagement. He doesn't want you to leave this place today being an onlooker, being an audience any longer. He wants you to be engaged in the battle. He wants you to be engaged in His kingdom. And then there's a group of people here that have been engaged for a long time. Matter of fact, you've been faithfully engaged. And God says, today is your day of emergence. And He's about to push you to the front. And Ms. Paglini, I saw that you changed your hairstyle today. But I feel like it's prophetic in the sense that God's about to bring a lot of change upon your life. He's bringing you from the background and He's about to push you forward into some things that have been laid up in your heart. And I told you last week, we live next door to each other. I could almost like not contain myself from coming over to your house because I could feel how God was about to bring you to the forefront. And Theron, I don't know where you are, but I charge you, you got to let it run. Don't put a harness on this horse. Because this girl, I'm going to tell you, she's not a girl, she's a woman, but she's going to begin to plow ground and you're going to see some things come forth from her. She's a firebrand. So I want you to stretch your hand out right now. And I want you to begin to pray for her because she has been engaged for a really long time. And she's been faithfully plowing and tilling and God's about to bring her forth. There's some things He's laid up in her that this world and the next generation needs. So God, we declare right now in the name of Jesus, we declare, God, that everything that You've laid up within her, that You begin to bring forth, God, with power, with revelation, Father, God, there be no hindrance, God. I declare a multiplication over her time, God. There be no fear, God. I thank You that her children are safe and protected, and God, as she goes out and she emerges, God, therefore her children will fall in line behind her, God. Her left and her right, on her front and her back, above and beneath her, Father. God, I thank You for a day of emergence. And God, not only your children, but there'll be many, many that emerge into their destinies because she stepped forward. Thank You. And so I don't want to like throw up your altar call. I'm going to get back into it. But I get up here fast to this altar. There's going to be people to pray for you. If you feel like you've just been observing, and it's your moment to engage. Let me say this, if you have been observing, don't miss this moment to engage. And the second thing, if you've been engaged and you've been faithful, but now you know that this word's for you, it's a time to emerge. God's gonna bring you forward. You're gonna step out. I want you to get up right now and get to the altar. Don't wait. Come on. Get up out of your seat and move forward. This isn't a joke, church. What He said, we have to emerge as the church. We can't be a subculture any longer. Don't be passive. Come on, some of you, your heart's pounding in your chest right now. It's pounding in your chest. Come on. You know God's got something for you. You know God's got something more for you. You know you've been engaged. You know you've been plowing ground. But all of a sudden now, there's something you've got to step into. You've got to step up into. It's your time. It's your season. All right, we're going to worship. I guess I have to give you the mic back.
Yeah.
There's no one like him. There's no one like him. We're going to have people stay up here and continue to pray. If you need prayer for anything, 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 we'll pray for you. Otherwise, I want to bless you. Expect God to do something through you this week. Let me pray for you. Lord, I thank you for this church. I thank you for this people. And God, I pray for your anointing. I pray for your power. That God, we would be countercultural. That we would be in step with you, bringing your kingdom here on earth as it is in heaven. I pray this in Jesus' name. God bless you. Have an awesome day.
would you do if he walked into the room? What would you do if he walked into the room? What would you say if he walked into the room? How would you praise if he walked into the room? How would you shout if he walked into the room? How would you shout if he walked into the room? What would you do if he walked into the room? Yes, what would you do? Trouble, here right now. The King is in the room. Your healer's in the room. Your Savior's in the room. Your provider's in the room. Your Redeemer's in the room. Your champion's in the room. He's in this room. So what will you do? Jesus Christ.